assessment of field responsiveness, the new frontiers. First of all, I want to declare that a member of the MAB, Medical Advisory Board of Pulsion, Mackay, but I also gave lectures, and today I'm giving a lecture for Massimo. You know the concept of field responsiveness. You know that not all patients are field responsive, even patients with shock. This is a review of the literature we did years and years ago, and among 400 patients hospitalized for shock, only 52% of patients responded to fluid administration in terms of increasing cardiac output. Also, we know from the literature, for example, from this study, but many others, that fluid overload or positive cumulative fluid balance is an independent predictor of mortality in patients with sepsis. So we have to keep in mind these two concepts. Therefore, the decision of starting fluid administration should be based on the presence of three elements. First, the presence of hemodynamic instability or peripheral hypoperfusion, motor skin, hypotension, oliguria, hyperlactatemia, whatever. First. Second element, the presence of preload responsiveness to avoid to give fluids to patients who are fluid unresponsive. And third, limited risk of fluid overload. These three elements are mandatory before deciding to give fluid to patients. I will focus on preload responsiveness, of course. We need some predictors of fluid responsiveness or unresponsiveness because they can help to choose the best fluid strategy by avoiding to fluid overload patients who would be fluid unresponsive. And now we have some consensus reports coming from the ESICM, this society, but also coming from the Surviving Sepsis Campaign guidelines. And these two papers say that it is better to use dynamic variables instead of static variables, like CVP, for example. Why? Because if you look at the Frank-Starling curve, we know that there is no one single curve, but a family of curves between a failing heart and a normal heart. And therefore, the value of preload can be associated with fluid responsiveness, preload responsiveness, or preload unresponsiveness. And what we need is to know the slope of the Frank-Starling curve at the time you decide to give something to patients. The slope can be obtained by dynamic indices of preload responsiveness. We can use either the heart-lung interaction indices or passive regressing test as a volume challenge. What about the heart-lung interaction indices? We can use the respiratory variation of stroke volume, and what is the idea behind? The idea behind is that mechanical ventilation induces cyclic changes in stroke volume only in patients with biventricular preload responsiveness. And also, fluid responsiveness occurs only in patients with biventricular preload responsiveness. So if you put these two physiological statements, you can have another one, which is that fluid responsiveness correlates with the magnitude of the cyclic changes in stroke volume induced by mechanical ventilation. This is the primary hypothesis. And how can we measure the changes in stroke volume during mechanical ventilation? One, we can use a surrogate of stroke volume, which is pulse pressure, the difference between the systolic and the diastolic pressure. Pulse pressure variation can be used, and if we have this kind of curves, of shapes, for example, in this situation, you can predict that the patient will respond to fluid because this high pulse pressure variation is associated with preload responsiveness, while no pulse pressure variation can be associated with preload unresponsiveness. This is the hypothesis we tested years ago in my unit with Frédéric Michard and colleagues, and we showed that pulse pressure variation, PPV, was far better than CVP and POP obtained by Swan-Ganz catheters, to predict the responsiveness. You see the area under the rocker, which is good for PPV and not for the other variables. And also, this result was confirmed by many other studies. This is a meta-analysis by a Chinese group in patients with mechanical ventilation receiving more than 8 ml per kilogram of tidal volume, and 22 studies were included, 800 patients were included, and as you can observe, PPV pulse pressure variation was able to predict the responsiveness with a good accuracy, and the area under the rocker was 0.94, and the threshold value was 12%. We can do the same with stroke volume variation. You know that some devices now are able to provide the value of stroke volume variation using the arterial pressure waveform, and analyzing this waveform, they can provide the value of SVV. And in this meta-analysis by Paul Merrick and co-workers, SVV was demonstrated to be a good predictor of responsiveness in ICU patients. And this is a recent paper published last month in Critical Care Medicine comparing studies that used these dynamic parameters and in the same study, in randomized studies that used one group was managed according to dynamic parameters and the other group was managed according to standard care without the knowledge of dynamic parameters in ICU patients. As you can observe, this is a meta-analysis. It was in favor of the use of dynamic parameters compared to control. So there is no doubt about this. These dynamic variables are very useful, not only for the doctor, not only for the nurse, but also for the patient. And we can do this maybe with pulse oximetry by looking at the plethysmographic signal variation. The advantage, of course, is that it is totally non-invasive and very easy to obtain. And this is one of the first papers published on this topic, and the leader was Maxime Canesson. They compared the shape of the arterial pressure waveform to the shape of the plethysmographic signal waveform. As you can see on this slide, this looks exactly the same. And arterial pressure is here, and plethysmography signal is here. And this looks exactly the same. And they compare this in a study, and they confirm in another study published in Anesthesiology 2 years later. And as you can observe, PPV on the x-axis and what they called delta pop at that time on the y-axis were well correlated, and the agreement using the Blum-Altman plots was acceptable. We did the same with Mark Fessel in our unit some years ago, and we also found a nice correlation between the changes in PPV and the changes in this variability of plethysmographic signal. And the question is now, can we use it as an index of field responsiveness? And I want to show you this meta-analysis by the group of Massimo Antonelli in Italy, and they used at that time in 2010, I think, all the studies that addressed the issue of field responsiveness using the variability of the plethysmographic signal. And they found that the area under the rocker for the prediction of responsiveness using this was 0.85. It's not 0.95, but it is 0.85. I can say that it is acceptable. And I want to distinguish two situations, the OR, or operating room setting, and the ICU setting. In the OR setting, there are good papers, good results in papers comparing the prediction of field responsiveness using the variability of this plethysmographic signal, here delta pop, compared to PPV, pulse pressure variation. They do the same as predicting for responsiveness, and far better than CVP and POP. And this is a typical tracing in a responder. Before giving fluids, you have this kind of shape of waveform, and after receiving fluids, you can see the attenuation of the variation of the plethysmographic signal during mechanical modulation. And this is a typical tracing in a non-responder. There was no change, neither before nor after fluid infusion. And in this paper, Maxime Canesson again used now an automatic calculation of this variability of the plethysmographic signal. And they call this a PVI, for plet variability index, PVI. And it is something which is implemented in a device, and the value of PVI is displayed here on this device. And you can look at the value easily. And in this paper, Canesson and co-workers showed that PVI was as good as pulse pressure variation to predict fluid responsiveness, and they found a threshold value of 14%. And also, PVI is very sensitive to change in hemodynamics. This is a study looking at PVI before and after fluid administration. As you can observe, PVI decreases easily and rapidly after fluid administration. And also, we have to think about the use of plethysmographic signal variation in ICU patients. We have some good results. In this study, by Natalini and co-workers in Italy, they compare the arterial pressure waveform variation, delta PP or PPV, to the plethysmographic signal variation, and they found good results in terms of prediction of responsiveness, and the threshold values were more or less the same, 15% in this study. We found also good results in our unit with Marc Fessel, and we found a threshold value of 12%. It was exactly the same value we found for this delta PPLET and pulse pressure variation. Also, another study from France by Lupek and co-workers comparing pulse pressure variation in ICU patients and PVI, plet variability index, measured by this Massimo device, and it was as good, PVI was as good as PPV and far better than other variables. And in this paper, they also look at the changes in cardiac output increased by fluid administration compared to the baseline value of PVI before giving fluids. And the higher PVI, the higher was the increase in cardiac output after fluid administration, and the opposite was true. But we have to be very careful in patients with shock receiving vasopressors, because in this situation, maybe PVI does not work very well. This is a study we did in our unit with Xavier Monet, and we compared the prediction of fluid responsiveness in septic shock patients receiving norepinephrine of pulse pressure variation, stroke volume variation, and PVI. As you can observe, it's not as good. PVI is not as good as the other variables, maybe because they receive norepinephrine, and there is some difficulties for the signal and to interpret the signal of the plethysmographic device. It's not a problem in reality, because these patients receiving norepinephrine, in general, are already equipped with an arterial catheter. So it's not the same issue compared to the operative room setting patients. This is an analysis of the literature by Frédéric Michard showing that the use in operating room of all these dynamic variables is associated with a decreased rate of complications, decreased length of stay, decreased in morbidity in general. And this study compared by Forger and co-workers compared two strategies intraoperatively. One strategy was to give fluids in function of the value of PVI, plet variability index, using the Massimo device. And another strategy was to give fluids in function of CVP and mean arterial pressure. So 82 patients were included in this study. It was performed in patients with major abdominal surgery, and they found that the primary endpoint was the change in lactate during surgery. In the control group, lactate increased a lot during surgery and stayed elevated after surgery, while in the PVI group, the lactate increased less during and after surgery. In addition, they measured the volume of fluid administered in these patients, which was lower in the PVI group control compared to the control group. Of course, there are many limitations to use these dynamic variables. There are some false positives and false negatives. This is why other tests can be used. And for example, the passive leg raising test, PLR, you know this test. Now it is recommended by the surviving sepsis campaign to be used to assess fluid responsiveness. And with Paul Marik and Xavier Monet, we showed in a meta-analysis published last year that it is a good test for predict fluid responsiveness. You can look at the area under the ROC curve, and the threshold value was 10%. And a question is how to measure cardiac output during this test. Of course, we can use many, many, many monitors, and this was demonstrated for many monitors, but maybe we can use the plethysmographic signal to do this. And this is the hypothesis we did with Xavier Monet and Alexandra Berton. We looked at the response of the perfusion index, which is also provided by the pulse oximeter, response to passive leg raising. In fact, what is the perfusion index? You have this kind of signal. The perfusion index is the ratio of the pulsatile portion due to systole divided by the non-pulsatile portion due to diastole. And the perfusion index is influenced by the local vasoconstriction or dilation, and by stroke volume. And it is more and more used now in patients. I will go fast because we have a short time to see that many papers now use the perfusion index for assessing hemodynamics. And this is what we did with Alexandra Berton and Xavier Monet. We hypothesized that the changes in perfusion index can be due to changes in stroke volume and cardiac output. And we compared this after and before passive leg raising and before and after fluid administration. You can observe a good correlation between the changes of these two variables. And also, more importantly, we showed that an increase in perfusion index by more than 9% in response to passive leg raising can predict an increase in cardiac index during passive leg raising more than 10%, that is to say, in fluid responders. So maybe it is an abstract. It's not a paper now. It will be presented in this Congress, but maybe we can use non-invasively the changes in perfusion index during passive leg raising to predict fluid responsiveness. So my conclusion, if we can use invasive devices, PPV, SVV, in most severe ICU patients, but we can use also pulse oximetry by looking at the plethysmographic signal variation or by looking at the response of perfusion index to passive leg raising, and this could be dedicated to less severe ICU patients, OR patients, emergency room patients, or wards patients. Thank you very much for your attention.